Ken's been involved in environmental issues. It's his life work. He's been doing this for years. He grows organic food. He actually developed the sustainable rural development curriculum for North Tech. And he's currently a community development officer with the Far North District Council. He's leading community economic development through food systems. Jamie, who's sitting in the middle there, is employed by North Tech, and he's a sustainable development and horticulture tutor there. He's got a broad range of horticulture interests, real interest in New Zealand native plants, organic food production, permaculture, and I'm going to let him explain what an ethnobotanical garden expert does. But he's got an emphasis on food. He's got iwi links all through Northland. He has a real interest in Maori social and economic development, and sustainability is something that he's very passionate about. He's got an experience in the distribution of fresh produce, and with he and his wife, he started the distribution of organic produce in a business called Greenlink. Which grew and was sourced from a lot of different organic growers, and he had outlets throughout New Zealand, Pack and Save, Progressive Enterprises, Auckland, and even down to Christchurch. So he's been in the business, and currently his main interest is in the development of fauna land, with beehives, and aquaculture and native plant and organic crops. How about that? And Robin, sitting right next to me here, he's the chairman and the manager of the New Zealand Tamarillo Growers Association. And for our overseas guests who may not even know what tamarillos are, Robin will tell you. He's been in that for 7 years. He was the leader that got through a particular disease that the tamarillos got a couple of years ago and worked their way through that, navigate the industry through that. In some real challenging years, we can say now that they're stabilized. And for the last 8 years, he and his wife have been developing local markets for their value-added product, the tamarillo products. And I can attest to it, and the gifts that we're giving out today are some of the vinegars and different products that they've created. And Auckland started asking for it, and now it's got to the point where he's got Australian markets and markets in the USA and likely Europe next year. So it's something that's a value-added product that's been grown here, processed here, and now going globally. And I think the interesting thing that I love about this story is he used the Whangarei Growers Market to get the recipe right. He would give samples every Saturday, and people kept saying, oh, a little bit sweeter, a little bit this. And so that's where the recipe finally came to. So without further ado, this is about Northland food production. And so, because there's such a diverse background here, I'm just going to let it flow. But I've got a few questions that I'm just going to start the discussion with, and then these guys, I know them all. They'll go where it needs to go. But the first couple of questions is about the current food production situation in Northland from their perspectives, as far as demand for local food production, and are we meeting it? And can we produce more? So we'll start with that.
No.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yep. I've watched the food situation in Northland for quite a few years now, and especially from a natural fruit food production or organic perspective, and being a tutor, I've also had to look very closely at the conventional side of things and taken people out to different locations, different growers, to work experience and just general visiting. The main thing that I've noticed is a decline in the number of conventional growers, and sadly, the slow growth of natural organic producers. So it's just how I'm looking at things at the moment, and you might note that I'm saying sadly the lack of natural producers. When I first looked into the situation of being a grower myself and looking for producers to supply my distribution business, I thought there would be a natural incremental increase, but it seems to have declined a little. It's just my point of view at this point.
Like Jamie, I've been involved in tutoring horticulture in Northland and also been a grower myself. But I'm probably learning more in my role in council than in my other roles, because I do a lot of travelling around our communities. So my comments are about the Far North district, not the Whangarei district, because Far North I'm familiar with. You're probably aware that we've got a hell of a lot of our land up here. Our land mass is in agriculture, and that's conventional industrial agriculture, and very little of our land in small farming ventures or horticulture and so on. So in terms of our ability to meet our food demand by using small farming type techniques, we're probably in the proverbial ditch if we're going to try and do things to meet just the demand we've got at the moment without increasing that demand. So I have a great deal of difficulty because I feel like I've got a foot in two camps here. And one is, am I trying to answer these questions from the perspective of we're sitting in a shag system and we need to do something about that to hold the ground that we've got at the moment and tinker with that system? Or are we trying to design a totally different system because we've all agreed that we need a different paradigm? And a different paradigm means that we have to let go of what we're doing, but we also have to have a transition period where we get to that different paradigm. So for me, our job, the job of all of us here, is to be totally aware of where we're trying to go, but what we have to do in the present, and then stage it out through those sorts of things that are going to happen around us. So we're buggered as far as food production is concerned, whether we're waiting for the industrial place to feed us or whether we're worrying about the small farmer and the local producer. We have to lift the game because people are beginning to wake up and they're wanting more. And if in the middle of all that, the stuff hits the wall, then we're not going to get anywhere at all. So that's my thoughts.
I can only talk from my perspective as involved in the Tamarillo industry, and certainly with the supply doesn't meet the demand. What I mean by that is that the total supply, I suppose, of Tamarillos coming out of Northland would be probably around about 40% of the national crop, but Northland would probably use about 2%. So, of course, naturally, most of our Tamarillos goes down to the larger Auckland area, and that's where most of it gets used. Just like to take a point of what Jamie mentioned about organic. There's been a lot of Tamarillo growers who try to grow Tamarillos organically, and as being the chairman and manager of the Tamarillo Growers Association for about 5 years, you see a lot of growers wanting to be organic, desperately trying to get away from chemicals. Now, we'd all like to get away from chemicals. Many have tried. No one has yet succeeded that I know of growing them commercially on a large scale. And that has nothing to do with the benefits of growing organically, for sure. There were a few organic growers in New Zealand up to about 2009, when the tomato potato psyllid came into the country. cause this horrific bacterium called Liberibacter, and that is a dreadful disease. And it's one of the reasons why our timber industry many years ago was producing 900 tonnes. It's now down to about 400 tonnes and slowly growing from there. Just about devastated industry. The only thing that really does take them out, unfortunately, are chemicals, but we do use soft chemicals. We don't use organophosphates or carbamates or anything nasty and toxic like that. So it's I come from a point of sympathising with Jamie and think, well, yes, we'd love to be organic, but I don't know of any grower who's actually growing tamarillos organically and being successful with it.
Thanks, Robin.
Can I ask a question?
At the end. We'll just hold questions till the end, please. Okay, so the second suite of questions is, are there obstacles to new growers getting established? And what resources or requirements are needed to establish new growers? For example, land, equipment, mentors, loans, education, that kind of thing.
A quick answer to that is that I don't see a shortage of land or equipment or mentors, but there's definitely a shortage of loans for people to have startup businesses. But to me, one of the problems of people starting up their businesses and starting in a way that's going to be farming ecological is having a population that's ecologically illiterate. You know, if we're going to try and solve the problems of agriculture by going down a different road and having an ecological form of agriculture, it's peeing in the wind if the rest of the population doesn't understand why you're doing that and are going to support you if they can always go to the shop and get a cheaper product. So one of the things we have to do is a hell of a lot of education so that everybody knows what their role is in the production of food and the consumption of food.
It takes a special breed of person to be a horticulturist or a farmer. And in some ways, that's the tricky bit for me. Watching people studying and doing a little bit of work experience, going out into the garden and, oh gosh, it's hot. Oh gosh, I'm tired. Oh, golly. And, you know, it's set, you know, do people just emerge? Do people get nurtured, cultivated? As Ken said, I don't think there's a lack of resources. I think there's seems to be a shortage of people that can handle it.
Yeah, I agree with Jamie, and I'm speaking from experience of being an orchardist for many years. The average age, and this is a concerning horticulture New Zealand too, the average age of orchardists is 67. So, and the problem here is that the people, the family coming up behind them, look at what the hard work that their parents are doing and saying, oh, I don't want any part of that. This is not sexy enough for me. I'm going to go into IT or something like that. And that's a fact. That is actually what's happening. So we, and that's one problem. The other problem as I see it, and I really believe this passionately, that there is a lack of career path in horticulture. I really do, because most of us horticulturists are owner operators. So if we employ staff, we'll employ them perhaps casually. 6 months a year, then they've got to find somebody else. We've got to find someone else as well. We can't, there's no possibility of training up. Maybe we might have a manager, but there's none of that hierarchy we see in other businesses where you might go from a store manager to an operations manager, there might be a marketing, human resource manager. We've got none of that. We're not a big enough organisation to be doing that. We need to grow, every business needs to grow. I know this is sort of going against what a lot of people have been saying, but perhaps I'm playing the devil's advocate here. But we do need to upscale our industry. If we're really serious about getting top people into our business, it's no good just coming and picking fruit for 6 months, say, ta-da, bye-bye. We need to know they've got to be on a career path. And that's the only way we're going to get committed, dedicated staff to get into our industry. And I honestly feel that's what is really holding our industry back. If you look at all the industries in the world, look at retail. Look how that's grown. Huge branches, huge retail chains taking over the supermarkets, taking over the hardware. Look at Bunnings and Harvey Norman. huge. You don't see many hardware mills, not a lot of dairies opening up now. Same on the freight situation. Same the bigger companies taking. Look at dairy, for example. When 20 years ago, the average dairy farm was 115 cows. It's now 450. Look at the orchards. Orchards are still, there's many small peels still struggling on. We need to, whether you call it corporate farming, I know that's a bit of a bad word, but we need to somehow or other get a larger scale. When we do that, we'll get professionals into our business, we'll get more people, more money coming into our business, those people got more access to loans, more technology will be in their business, and of course then we're looking for skilled staff. But at the moment, we're just looking for somebody who can pick fruit off trees.
Okay, there might be a little bit of repetition here, but the next couple of questions are about, is there a successful transition from the horticulture education to new growers actually getting established? And I think, Ken, you started to allude to that about, you know, loans or whatever, and I think that's where we want to go with this one a bit. And I think, yeah, let's just use that one, because I think the next one will stand on its own.
I don't think we can answer this in isolation. I think we need to go back to what Robin's just outlined, and that is, what are we trying to produce the graduates for? Are we trying to produce them for the industry as it has been and keep on growing that industry, or are we trying to produce them for another industry that is totally different? Now, back in about 2001, when I set up along with a couple of other people, set up the Diploma in Sustainable Rural Development, it was designed to get people to come out of the Polytech with a two-year diploma in agriculture and organic horticulture and agriculture with an understanding of how to set up their own business and operate that in an organic way. The Polytech killed that because it wasn't producing people for the industry. Okay, so that's what I'm getting at with the context. What in the hell are we trying to do? Because if we don't make up our mind about that, we're going to be all over the shop. We have to be really, really honest about the task that's ahead of us and try and change or create our own system, because it's proving almost impossible to drag the old system along. Mm-hmm. So it's people that can see. And so they've got to have a huge ecological literacy, and the population in general has to have some ecological literacy to understand how they make the choices.
Thanks, Ken. Yeah, I've watched people evolve, come along with an interest, do some study, and then they disappear. And it's sort of been sad in some ways, but it's also a bit much to ask that people after a short couple of years of courses have an expectation that they could go and run their own business. I think you need at least 10 years of experience in your field, and then the business side of things, the entrepreneurial side of things, is another beast altogether. And so I have sympathy for some people that come into the field and think, yes, I'd really like to do this as a business on my whenua, and then get despondent and give it up.
Follows on from what I said before, really. I think it's a bit like a push-pull philosophy going on here. I think we need, instead of getting students pouring out of Unitech looking for work, we need to look at the other way, and we need to create a demand for these people. So that's why, as orchardists, we need to upscale our businesses so that we've got opportunities there for these people, and then we can seek them out of these institutions without these people coming in here looking desperately for work. It's got to work the other way. So somehow or other, we've got to get our industry in line with every other industry that's happening in New Zealand to create more demand for our workers. And when that happens, of course, and they'll just go up through the hierarchy. And I believe that's what I believe that's where we should be going looking at.
Thanks, Robert. And this is another related question, and I think I knew the age was getting up there. I didn't realize it was 67. But this one is about how can those growers that are retiring pass on their experience, wisdom, and ensure there's succession of new, younger growers. And I know at the growers market, I think we lost three this year, and we're going to lose another couple next year of medium-sized growers. And I can't help but go too far, but when you look at the whole share milking concept, whether or not there's something in that that could be applied to this, where you get a student that works alongside the dairy farmer, starts learning the business, and gets profit from the dairy farmer, and ultimately I think they can buy them out or take them over. But anyway, so that's the question.
I should mention that those three people they lost from the growers market died.
One way or the other, they need to be replaced.
Yeah, I'm not sure how established growers that are phasing out can assist if they want to, if they're sick of it, or if they want to mentor people on. I'm sort of interested in some ways of what Ken's been alluding to is, you know, perhaps is, you know, putting energies in a different, might be slow, might take time, but my interest really is the development of Maori land. There's lots of parcels of land sitting around that have unique soils, unique microclimates, and a labour force. Beekeeping is really taking off in the Maori world, and there's some very interesting things going on. And to fit in with the paradigms that we saw yesterday, the models that we saw yesterday with the Lady Price, Rangi Marie, I think there's lots of scope for that, with things like aquaculture, using tuna as in the eel, kiwi. I'm looking into helping a family with their watercress patch and maybe integrating those things into it. And so beekeeping, aquaculture, crop production, stock, all of this can be done on Maori land, and the people can be eating their own fresh food as well as selling their surplus. And there's got to be a plus, positives, in this way of thinking, and that's where I'm putting my energy. You know, I don't really, you know, worry about people that have got to the end of their time, and all of this information here that's available is online in other people's heads. If you know that ex-grower, you can go to him and talk to him. All of these things are here. I think it's time now that people start looking at their whenua and say, what can I do here? Who can I get to help me? Have I got the kaha to do this? Mm. Kia ora.
The whole thing is a wicked problem. It's can we get people to come into horticulture, agriculture, and make the changes we're looking for without us changing the education system? So, you know, we've got all these things that are running parallel and have been supporting each other for years. And well, that's the theory, they've been supporting each other. But if a young person gets mentored or apprentices themselves to an older orchardist or grower or whatever it is, they're still going to get caught up with all sorts of regulations about safety programs and all that sort of thing. So we have to kind of work this whole thing through so that those things either don't matter, and I'm not saying the safety doesn't matter and the hygiene doesn't matter, but the pieces of paper don't matter, because that other system and that other way of doing things that's been running for so many years has become a behemoth that doesn't bloody work. And we have to make something that works, and we have to make it soon. All right? And I know there's huge amounts of good stuff going on, but we have got a gigantic job to do in a very short space of time. and we have to find brave young people who may not have a degree or anything at the end of the line. They may still have all the skills they need to go out and operate a piece of land and no money to do it with. But we have to solve those problems and bring the whole lot in as part of our work. It's wonderful to have people like Barbara and Anne here, and to have the health department people and, you know, PHO folk here. We're starting to break that ground, but it's one hell of a job because the systems we're trying to break away from are so entrenched and they're so myopic. And so when we even, and I'm not getting at Robin or anybody in this, when we talk about the Tamarillo problem and the need to, you know, get bigger and so that we can employ the graduates when they come out, we're building a monoculture. And monocultures are something we're supposed to be moving away from. And that's what I said at the beginning. It's this context. What is it that we're trying to do? We've got to get that very, very clear in our heads, because otherwise we're just putting Band-Aids on the old bits. So Lord knows where we go, but there's a thought.
Yeah, I'm sort of adopting a commercial approach to this. If you look at the benefits, let's look away from it, look at the benefits of Northland. Like just a basic SWOT analysis, right? The strengths. What are the strengths of Northland? We've got beautiful, beautiful tropical climate. We've got beautiful volcanic soil. Proximity to Auckland, where our main market is. We've got a deep water port. We've got everything going. We've got a good labour supply, excellent training facilities. You look at our weaknesses, perhaps you could say, well, okay, it's we've got we haven't branded our product as well as we could, perhaps. We need a formal structure. We haven't got a formal group structure like what we should have. Look at the opportunities. We've got Auckland right on our doorstep. We've got so many things going for us. We can just about grow anything we want here. But we just need to, I suppose I'm looking at this thing from more of a commercial aspect. And we need to grow to a certain size. We need to, and you might call it monoculture. I don't see an issue with that. But it's, we do need to grow to a certain size. We've got examples all over the world, all over New Zealand, where they've done just that. And some have bombed out, sure. But other ones have been very successful.
Okay, well, something that you just said there, Robin, about adequate labor force, and I just want to just have a little bit of a discussion after that, and then we'll open it up for questions.
Can we open it up shortly?
Pardon?
Can we open it up shortly for people to
feel it? That's exactly what I just said, wasn't it?
Okay, where you go.
I can feel the energy coming from
you. Yeah.
good. Yeah, pardon? Okay. It's just, okay, well, this might come into the questions and whatnot, but we talked earlier about the labor force to pick, and that's usually, and it's seasonal, and there's all kinds of reasons that we're struggling with that. But my understanding is, at least in the mid and far north, the labor force is mainly visitors and islanders. It's not locals. I think that's a little bit prevalent in this district too, but so there's laborers that you've talked about getting them into the business and a career path and all that, and then there's just the labor force of picking this. So if we get into production and we don't have anyone to pick it, is that an issue, and how do you guys see that? And then we'll open it up. And Leslie, you got the first go.
Yeah, it's true. It's mainly backpackers or woofers, as we often call them. These are people who basically work for free, and you just provide them accommodation and meals. And a lot of orchardists rely on that labour force. And you can't really say that's particularly sustainable.
That is sustainable.
And it's not much of a career pathway. Yeah. And North Tech this year has sort of made a push to get more involved in industry, you know, and putting people in the position where an employer can check them out. And I think it's a good thing. And, you know, even though I'm talking about Maori land, organics, you know, we're part of a diverse situation. And we've all got a lot in common, and there's no, you know, I really respect people that have successful operations, and I actually had one of Robin's students working in one of my classes. There's actually a couple of people in here that were my students. I think it would be preferable to have people from this locality to be the labour force, but when you've got to get off a benefit and get sometimes end up with a net amount less than if you just stayed at home and did something, there's all of these things that come into the picture, and you can't blame the people for being like that. You know, you go off and work for somebody for peanuts, and then it's hard to get back on when the work runs out, and you'll end up having to lean on each other to survive. And I think what Robin said earlier, that we have to make it a pathway, that you're not just a picker. Later on, you're something else. At another time in the season, you're something else. And that's the sort of angle that we're working with Coomera growers over in Dargaville. That's where I will be based this year. And rather than just being a seasonal worker, we want to try and get people to be there for the long term with a career. One of my students, a young woman, she hit the her employer up, "Hey, I'm sick of doing all this. I want to be the tractor driver," not the person that runs along picking up the stuff. And we've sort of worked out ways now where she can be employed for a much longer term. So I think with the horticulture industry being so seasonal, it does have its limitations.
Wouldn't it be incredible if we had something like Jamie and Robin have just alluded to, and it had a balance of our own people in a program where they went and did that work, and they learned a lot of skills and they moved through different industries, and then when they had shown the aptitude and interest, they then went to the Polytech and they did their studies, and then they went further and further. I feel that we've got to work with our Pacific neighbours because it's part of the economic and social justice. And we've also got to lift our own Indigenous people because that's a huge part of the social justice that we're responsible for. So making good food is probably the most honest thing that you can do. And if we could use the making of good food to bring people together and to lift people, then that would be an incredible legacy that all of us could leave. So there's some thought.
Okay.
The student that worked in my class, that worked for Robin, I said, "How come you're coming to my course?" And he said, "Oh, because my boss said I have to."
And that's what I said to Dave. I said, "Look, you want to work here, I want to put you on a level 3 horticultural course. And if you can prove yourself, then your next step could well be a managerial position." He worked with us for 2 years. But unfortunately, he had a few problems at home, and he would get paid, and the next day he wouldn't turn up. And that happened about 3-4 times, and finally I just had to let him go. Very sad end of that story.
John?
Bananas.
Yeah, Cam was saying, you know, do we look for solutions within the existing paradigm, or do we actually start trying to create a whole new paradigm? And I'd wonder if he put any meat on those bones.
He's had that marker pen ready for this. This wasn't a point question, by the way.
Thank you. I've been itching. This some of you will know this graph. This is from an organization called the Natural Step. And the Natural Step talks about the state of the environment and the natural resources of the earth. Okay? And this axis here is about time.
Time.
And it's indisputable that over the last whatever years you want to look at, but let's take Industrial Revolution 200, 250, that the human population has been putting demands on the environment and on the state of our natural resources so that that's the resulting trend. We've got an increasing demand over time. And concurrent with that, we've got a situation where the ability of the earth to deliver more iron, more phosphate, more oxygen, and so on, amenable climate is doing that. And you can't dispute that. So if that's what we've got, and we've got 7.4 billion people travelling into that funnel, like a clot going into a narrow artery on somebody's heart, then we know what the effect is. Back in about 1976, the Earth overshot its carrying capacity because of the way that we were using resources and the number of people that we were using them. So since that time in particular, this has got pretty serious. We don't know where we are in this funnel, but we're in a bloody funnel, that's for sure. And we don't know how long we've got before we start really bumping against the sides, but I suggest we already are, and that's what the mass extinction is trying to tell us. That's what our fellow travellers are telling us, that we're blissfully ignoring. This situation is totally unsustainable. What we have to do is find a way through that before it totally closes over on us, and there is no possibility that anybody in the human population is going to go through that period of time. So this piece here, and we don't know how long that is because we haven't been there before either, is what's called the transition. So here's unsustainability staring you in the face. Here's a period of transition to when we actually get our shit together and we start to work out what it is that you actually have to do to stop making those demands on the resources of the earth and let the earth recover. And if we can get some people, and it's this blunt, folks, if we can get some people, wherever that is on the planet, through to that stage, then they will be able to live sustainably. And we don't know what those time frames are. But we have to do something to our agricultural system right now so that we start getting prepared. And then we have to have something going on in our agricultural system that can handle this part. And it will be our grandchildren or beyond that that will be figuring out what to do there. So that's what I was trying to get at before about the context. What is it that we're trying to do? We've got to try and use what we've got to the best of our ability at the moment so that we can still produce some food, but be mindful that that's the system that's been crushing us and killing the planet. So we actually have to have a different system for in here. And we leave, that worry to our kids. Do we owe this bit to our children and our children's children?
Your industrial, but a military complex.
Okay. So thanks for the question.
I just want to bring up this quote again. This will wrap it up. Trust me.
Trust me.
I can see everyone's starting to go, oh, God.
So it's back to the quote that I left with the other day. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. It's the only thing that ever has. So I would just say to this group, and I was going to save this till later, but the parade has started to get through this transition period, right? We can choose to join it or watch it. That's what we'll leave you with for lunch. Where you want to be.